In the Garden of Eden tonight.
It's always been a mystery. What has happened? Who has done it? What is wrong with the pastor? Mama. Mama, please talk to me.
I can't talk about it. I can't.
Please.
I can't.
Mama, what? Okay. Can we please at least get a seat and see if
I
we
can't,
can.
I can't.
If you can
It's hard to talk about. I'm
please. Mama Josephine, you're scaring me. But, okay.
I did not know getting married to a pastor would be so hard. It's frustrating. I used to think it was the biggest blessing of my life, yeah. But how can it be the biggest blessing of my life when I feel like this? Frustrating.
Mama,
I can't take it anymore.
Mama, it's okay. It's okay. Let me hold your bag. And I think we should get a place. People will find you crying. Please. Mama, it's okay.
I can't do it anymore.
It's okay.
I can't.
Let's sit. Mama, this one.
Like, there are so many things I just don't understand. We used to be perfect.
Yes, we see you. We've been seeing you in church.
Just then, before he actually got loved by so many people, I don't know. Girls are always flaunting themselves in front of him. They're always trying so hard to get attention from him. I've even advised him to get a secretary that is a man because...
Oh, Bambi, I hear you.
You think?
I hear you so much.
He has no time for his family anymore. And I would understand if he was spending all that time in church. But for example, right now, we are from church.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for him. I've been waiting for him for over 3 to 4 hours now. And he's just there. Apparently, he's counseling. But he counsels even through the night. Which kind of counseling is that?
None. I honestly
don't know what to do.
Mama.
I don't know what to do anymore. I really wish.
Mama, I hear you.
That's something I could do for myself because I love him. Yeah. I cannot leave him because of our children.
Yes.
But then I'm only suffering. I'm hurting because he's never there. The kids are always asking for him. And he's always talking to these women. The people he counsels are always women. I don't know if I'm overthinking or... I just don't know what to think.
But have you talked to him about had this talk with
him? I've tried.
And what is his response?
He just keeps avoiding me and pushing me away.
And prayed about it, you know?
I have. At this rate, I feel like God has forsaken me because I don't understand my husband anymore.
He hasn't forsaken you, God. Yeah. He's still there with you. And he knows all the pain that you're going through.
My husband doesn't love me anymore. He doesn't.
No, don't say that, Mama.
What can I say?
Mama, what
would you think if it were you in my place? You want me to know? I've tried everything. I have tried to talk to him. Mm. I have tried
Yeah,
I even make sure the kids go to sleep early so that I can stay awake and wait for him.
Yeah,
but you know what time he comes back?
I don't know.
He comes back at 2 in the night. What type of counseling is that?
But, Mama.
What am I supposed to do?
Mama.
Do I still have to think he's doing the work of the Lord at 2 in the night?
Mama, you know you married a man of God.
I know.
All his life is devoted to God. He's ever in church, weddings, he's counseling people. Mami, all he does is, really honestly, he's doing it for God. I'm sure he's not doing anything else, at least. I'm sure he's really doing it for God. He's a man of God.
It's not that I don't want him to do the Lord's work. I understand. But I just need him to create time for his family. I need him to assure me. Because if he's even avoiding me, then it only makes it worse. It does not make it any better. Believe me, it does not make it any better. It doesn't.
Mama Josephine, I may not be in position to understand everything, but I hear you. But I know of a lady. She's called the marriage anchor. She could help you in this particular issue. She's a woman of God. She has counseled very many people. Very many friends of mine have gone there with issues in their marriages, and they came out well. Actually, even me, she's helping me with my premarital counseling with my fiancé. That is where I was coming from. After the service, I went there. She's really doing a good job. She's a woman of God. She, trust me, she will help you out with this issue.
Are you sure?
Yeah, trust me.
Please tell me it will work because I'm willing to do anything just to get my husband back.
Mama, it will work. It will work.
I'm willing to do anything.
I have a contact. I can give you her contact. And then you schedule an appointment with her, and she does everything in a godly perspective.
You are welcome in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. Yes, I am here. You guys, before I come on set, just so you know, there are always things that I am thinking about, people that I'm imagining. And yes, on a day like this, when I'm here and I'm like, I would have loved that someone is seated by my side. So what I do, I'm giving you a secret, head on. What I do, I imagine that he is standing behind the camera, and so I keep looking at him, and yes, that is why you see I come, I am all smiling and glowing. Yes, you are tuned into the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, and as you can see, I am excited, I am blushing, I am very happy. Why? Because of what just happened. Did you watch the act? Banange, that lady can cry. You can't even believe that she was acting. You can even think that it was for real. But yes, that is a foundation for the topic that we are going to be discussing. That is a background. That is a problem statement. Yes, emphasizing so that you get to feel the shoes or the heat of a wife, of a man of God, or the office of the ministry of a wife of a man of God. Now, when I got saved back in 2002, the very first thing that I wanted to be, if you asked me, Prosy, now that you have gotten saved, what did you want to do? There were two things on my bucket list, my salvation journey bucket list. One of the things I wanted to do, I wanted to serve the Lord. Full-time, this one that you see, the office where I was supposed to be serving the Lord, but it was very certain in my heart that I wanted to serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my strength, and with all that I am. Number two is that I wanted to be a wife of a man of God. Yes, that was like I wanted just those two. That is all that I ever wanted to be. Then, who knows what I'm thinking right now, but of course, as you all know, there's this ring, so, and he's not a man of God, so. I wanted to be a wife of a man of God. Then, yes, and I would pray, I would imagine, I would envision, I would see myself being called Mama. I remember in one of the churches that I attended, while I was at school, they used to call me Mama. I was in charge of mentoring the young ladies or the single ladies. And man, people would look up to me. People would, you know, adhere to the messages or the information or advice that I would give them. I was kind of anchoring because I was in charge of the young ladies. They used to be called the young ladies in the church, and we have these meetings, and I would come out boldly, and you know, people my age were looking up to me. I was committed, and yes, because then I was not yet married. And I always believed that I would marry a man of God. So tonight I'm going to discuss something that is closest to my heart. I may not be the wife of a man of God right now, but that does not mean that I cannot stand in the shoes and discuss the topic. Why? It is not by might, it is not by power, it is not by experience, but it is by the gift of the Holy Spirit, or by the Spirit of the living God, that I do what I do, that I teach about everything that I teach about. Yes, I have not experienced everything that I give you every single day, but the Lord has given me the revelation, and if He's given me the grace to walk with you into what it takes to be a wife of a man of God, I will do it. So at this point, I'm going to give you a very simple task. Mm-hmm. If you know anybody that is married to a man of God now, I know that all of us are men and women of God in our capacities from the time that we believe in the Lord. But now I'm referring to the people, those that are gifted with the fivefold ministry offices, which include the prophets, the teachers, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers like yours truly, your marriage anchor, or the apostles. I miss out the apostles. Yes, it is the teaching ministry, the apostolic ministry, the evangelistic, the prophetic, and yes, the pastoral ministries. Those are the fivefold offices that I am talking about now. I'm just going to give you a background of why it is called a ministry of a wife of a man of God. Why is it called a ministry now? These people are sacred. The people that are called into the fivefold ministry are not like any ordinary person. So this is a special calling. It is a special office that is given to men that are supposed. Mark my words, I'm saying supposed. So which means if you see anybody that is not, it does not mean that that is who they are. No, they are supposed to be God's representative more than anyone of us here on earth. And when I'm saying of us, I'm generalizing. Of course, you guys know that I am a teacher. So yes, I'm just speaking on behalf of the ordinary person. These are people that are sacred from before they were even conceived in their mother's womb. Yeah, they are ordained, they are given this ministry, they are given this office, and they are given special grace, special responsibilities. Why? Because they are supposed to fend for the church of Christ. They are the ones that are entrusted with the keys of the kingdom to be unlocking them on behalf of the general body of Christ. So their office is very sensitive, is very important, and yes, it is one that should be heeded to. Now, when it comes to the institution of marriage or who these people should marry, it cannot be anybody, it cannot be anyone, it cannot be perceived from a carnal perspective. No, 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 it cannot happen, because their office is extremely sensitive by its nature, and so they require somebody that is extremely special, extremely gifted, extremely anointed, positioned, trained, tried, tested, and yes, there must be a blue tick of the Lord God Almighty saying, yes, I stamp this relationship, I approve of this person, yes, they qualify to marry my servant that I have called into the fivefold ministry. You also, these are sacred people, and so we can also call this episode the ministry or the sacred wife. Yeah, the sacred wife or the ministry of a wife of a man of God. Any of the episodes will suit it. So I'll just go right into it by actually starting by who should these men of God marry? Now that I've said they are supposed to be special, now that's on a general perspective. Special, unique, sacred, and all that. But what kind of person? Let's get into defining. Because before we get to know their ministry, we need to know who is this person supposed to marry. Now, if you are a man of God, you have a calling of God upon your life, you better pay close attention, just in case you didn't know. I have been in different ministries, and when I see some of these unmarried men of God, you know, that are still developing and they are still at the establishment level of their ministries, and you know, they are dating here and there. Others are still single. I always ask them, are you dating? If they are dating, I will go ahead and ask, is the person you are dating approved by the Lord? Is it somebody you are supposed to be with? And I go ahead and tell them, you see, for you, you're special. You are not like any other person. You're not like your friends, your brothers, your sisters. No, you're classmates. You are a man of God. That is why they are called men of God. So let us look at the kind of wife that is supposed to be marriage material for this man of God from the fivefold ministerial offices. And to get that, we shall go into Deuteronomy chapter 7 from verse 2 to 4. This is the background when the Lord God was marking out God's chosen people. Just like I've just told you that a man of God is chosen, is set apart, is separated, is sacred, and yes, they are anointed before they were even placed in their mother's womb. Before their soul, their spirit is sent here on earth, they are already anointed, just like it is in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5 that says, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you and I appointed you a prophet. So these men of God are appointed before they are even put in their mother's womb, because their kind of life, their kind of calling is extremely crucial, very sensitive to the Lord God Almighty. So what kind of people should these men of God marry? What kind of wife should these men of God marry? We are in Deuteronomy chapter 7. I'll start from verse 2, and it says, and when the Lord your God delivers them over to you, these are statutes that the Lord God was putting up or establishing for the children of Israel, because they were set apart, they were chosen, and yes, they were special people and sacred to him. And these are the instructions regarding marriage that he was giving them, or that he's giving you today that is watching. Then he says, and when the Lord your God delivers them over to you, you shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them, nor show mercy to them. Then verse 3, which is what I'm looking forward to, nor shall you make marriages with them. Who are these people? You're wondering. Let's go back to verse 2, and I tell you who these people are. They are the Hittites, they are the Girgashites, they are the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, the seven nations that were into Canaan that the children of Israel were coming to conquer once they reached the promised land. And these were non-believers. So the Lord God gives a very strict instruction, and he says, you shall not make marriages. You shall not is a command. It is not a suggestion. So if you are a man of God, you shall not make marriages with non-believers. Period. Why should you not do that? You shall not give your daughter to their son, nor take their daughter for your son. Why? For they will turn your sons away from following me to serve other gods. So the anger of the Lord will be aroused against you and destroy you suddenly. Have you heard? So if you are a man of God, you cannot, you should not, it's a command, you cannot intermarry with a non-believer. For you, it is actually an abomination if you did, just to emphasize the point. You cannot. Why? Because they will corrupt your spirit. You know, like the Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter, I think 6 from verse 15, 16 and 17, that says that you cannot join yourself, or if you join yourself to a prostitute or a harlot, you will become one with her. One with what? With the evil spirit that is in this person who is a non-believer. So for a man of God, you must, number one, the kind of person that you look forward to is their spirituality. They must believe in the Lord God Almighty just like you do. I hope that is out of the way. So those of you men of God that are still looking at the outside appearance and you're like, she's hot, she's what, she's classy and all that stuff, that is a no-go area for you. Number one quality is that they must believe in the Lord God Almighty, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Number two is that you, as a man of God, you are a king. Not just a priest, because most of you, we know that you are a priest. No, you are a king. Now, you may be wondering and saying, but marriage anchor, we thought kings were the traditional rulers that we know about. And let me convince you of this, to establish that fact. But I know that most of you know that actually you are a king. And if you are a king, you must marry a queen, not just anybody. For now, let's just look at Revelations chapter 1 from verse 4 to 6. Let me just go to 5. And from Jesus Christ and the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and the ruler over the kings. Jesus Christ, let me read it again. And verse 5 of Revelation chapter 1. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, and the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth. So the Lord Jesus Christ is the ruler of me and you, the kings of the earth. So as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, we reign with him in the heavenly places. Of course, you know this. So you are a king. I just wanted to convince somebody that was wondering, okay, marriage anchor, how do we become kings? So you, as a man of God, as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are a king. And so you cannot marry just anybody. The person you marry must be queenly. They must possess these attributes that qualify them to be queens. Why? Because you are a king. Okay? So if maybe you're a man of God and you're wondering, like I told you, I want us to first look at the qualifications for a person that qualifies to be a wife of a man of God, and then we shall see their ministry, their office, what they are supposed to do. So that if you are the person that is still dreaming like the marriage anchor when I had just gotten saved and you want to marry a man of God, you had better know the responsibilities that are awaiting you, and of course what I have defined or called or termed as the ministry of a wife of a man of God. Okay, each man of God has a spiritual territory which they must rule over. You understand that, which translates into their physical dominion. So as a man of God, you have a territory where you reign, where you rule, because you are a king. So kings have got jurisdictions where their authority operates. So that's your territory. So as a king, because you are a king, you have this territory where you reign and rule with Jesus Christ. We know this in the spiritual realm, guys, not on the physical plane. In the spiritual realm, and of course I know that you do understand that. So therefore, as a king over that territory where God has given you, you need to make sure that you have the right queen that will come and support you into reigning and ruling within that territory where you have been positioned. Of course, let's look at one of my best stories in the Bible. And when I say best stories, I'm talking about myself. One of my favorite stories, okay, not the best, but it is one of my favorite stories in the Bible, which is the book of Queen Esther, or the book of Esther, that will give you a true definition. Now, what I was giving was just on the general overview of what you need to look out for if you are a man of God and you're looking for a wife that is supposed to be yours. These are some of the signs that you will find. But at this point, I want to just take you into the story of the book of Esther. We know that she is a queen, or she was a queen, and she was married to a king. So if you're looking out for this queen, these are the attributes of that queen. So we are just going to go into the book of Esther and look at the details that it gives us about the qualities of a wife, or the one who is supposed to be a wife of a man of God. Number one is that this person cannot be someone that is naturally, okay, that is insubordinate. People with big heads, hard-hearted, stiff-necked. As a man of God, that one is not a queen. I'll just stick to the word queen, so that you'll be like, but marriage anchor, supposing she's a work in progress, you see, I'm a man of God, I'm supposed to be patient. No, if someone has that spirit in them, and you can see it even before you start, you know, taking them to the altar, you're dating or you're just watching, and there's a lot of insubordination, okay, there can be some exceptions, but generally the queenly character is that this person is supposed to be absolutely submissive. Why am I saying that? In the introduction of the book of Esther chapter 1, those of you that have read it, I'll just give you a summary. We look at a queen that was replaced by Esther. Do we remember? She was called Vashti. Now, Vashti was a queen married to King Xerxes or Ahasuerus, Ahasuerus, however you want to pronounce it, this king of Persia. But because she was insubordinate, she disrespected her husband, the king. Publicly, she was dethroned, and that is how Esther comes in to actually come and take the throne. So if you want to be a rightful queen, a wife of a man of God, you cannot be insubordinate. So, men of God, there you have it. Look out for that girl, that lady in your church that is not insubordinate. You will be looking at a queen, one of those attributes. Of course, as we continue to discuss the attributes or the properties, the qualities of somebody who should qualify to be a wife of a man of God. And of course, we are looking at the characteristics at this point of a queen. Okay, number two is that this person that you're looking forward to marrying must be prepared to live an exemplary life. The other day we did an episode on the responsibility of being married to influence. Now, this is now the responsibility of being married to a man of God. Now, this is extremely sensitive. You must be willing to live an exemplary life. You can't just be like, no, me, I'm an ordinary person. No, not a wife of a man of God. Now, your husband is a pastor, apostle, prophet, evangelist or teacher, you are very different and you have lots of people looking up to you. So if you're the kind of person that is not ready, or the kind of person that is not ready to be, you know, to be exemplary, they want to live their life, do whatever they want to do whenever, no, my sweetheart, it cannot happen when you're going to marry a man of God. So you must be willing to be the example. I remember actually in this very context of the book of Esther, when Queen Vashti was rebelling or disrespecting the husband, the advisors of the king said that, you know what, if we do not punish this queen and we let her misbehavior go unpunished, some of our women will hear of what she did and will start behaving likewise. Why? Because she was a role model. So as a wife of a man of God, you must be prepared to be a role model. Full stop. If you don't want to be a role model, do not answer that call. Don't say yes. Because lots of people are looking up to you, and whatever you do sets a precedence. You know? You're the yardstick. People will look up to you. They want to look like you. They want to do what you do. They want to talk like you. You are a role model. You are an influencer. You have young girls that are looking at you. Mchala wa pastor, you know, the prophet's wife, the teacher's wife, you know, the apostle. People are looking up to you. So that is an office where you will lose your privacy, you lose your right, because you are there. People are watching every action that you take. So you must be prepared to live as an example in the church, in the ministry, in the society where the Lord God has placed your husband. The other one is that you must be able to attain a good character in order for you to become a queen. And that will require that you will go or undergo a beautification process. Now, some of us, I know that we come from different backgrounds and you've had hardships. And yes, you're called, because a wife of a man of God is somebody that is predestined. God predestines everybody, but for a wife of a man of God, you are set apart. Like one of the ministers or a guest that I hosted here in the Garden of Eden told us that actually you become one before you even get married. Why? Because the spirit God joins your two spirits before you even manifest on the physical plane. Yeah. So you are already joined, your spirit and his spirit, your man of God I'm talking about. Yeah. So he's already there, fixed, and you're already one. So by the time you come, God has orchestrated and made sure that you will end up as husband and wife. Yeah. So there must be, even when you have that calling and the spirit, you're already his wife. The heaven is witnessing that you people are meant to be together. because of the circumstances where you grew up, family background, education background, society, this whole life that happens, especially if you're not raised in a strong Christian family, lots of things happen. Maybe you've had heartbreaks, you've had disappointments, you've had lots of things, unfortunate things that happen, or challenges. So this somehow can corrupt or may have corrupted your character. So there must happen a beautification process. For you, you are different. You can't just wake up and you come with all your deficiency in character and you're going to be a wife of a man of God. No, you are sacred. And so, and because the Lord has ordained and predestined you to be married to a man of God, He will somehow train you subconsciously or intentionally, whether you know it or not. Somehow, somewhere, circumstances, situations will come that will panobit you and remove all the impatience, remove all the pride, and remove all the anger, remove all the worry, the anxiety. Somehow you will come when you're ready. Why? Because the office that you're going to occupy is extremely sensitive. You cannot be impatient, for example. You can't be jealous. You can't imagine if you're going to be jealous over people that are going to be coming to your husband for counseling, just like the act that we saw that played. You can't be one that cannot easily discern. Like, there's a lot of requirement, there's a lot of responsibility, a lot of character growth, maturity that must happen in order for you to qualify to be a wife of a man of God. And like I said, this can happen intentionally or can happen subconsciously, which is something that the Lord God will do for you, because He knows the future that He has aligned up for you. I will just take you into the book of Esther. One of the things that qualified Esther to be the excellent queen that we look up to and admire, and she was able to stand up to the challenge that she was faced under the rulership of King Xerxes, of course inspired by yours truly Haman, you know, that was representing the enemy. There's a beautification process that happened, you know, that 12 months, a full year of preparing them before any one of those maidens would appear or have their one night with the king. They had to go through a beautification process, a cleansing, you know. And we find that in Esther chapter 2, verse 12, where they tell you that there were 6 months of the beautification with the oil of myrrh, and then, of course, another 6 months with the oil of myrrh, 6 months with the perfumes, and all these were cleansing procedures. And yes, they symbolize something that I'm going to be discussing here. And why were they doing this? Because, like I said, there were lots of challenges, lots of circumstances that had happened, unfortunate things. I don't want to go into the story of Esther, so that's why I'm looking at the circumstances that represent what is given here in the scripture, or why we must go through the beautification process. Let's go into the symbolism of understanding the beautification process, especially with the oil of myrrh. Mm-hmm. So that you will understand what I'm talking about now. The beautification with the oil of myrrh basically symbolizes the fact that you must be flexible emotionally. You know, oils are used for massages, for the softening of the skin, for the, you know, softening of the joints. You go for massage and oils are applied, your skin is smooth, it is soft. So if we get the symbolism out of that, this is you being able to be flexible emotionally. Can you handle emergencies? Because with a man of God, anything can happen anytime. So can you stand and handle and endure that emergency and remain flexible, be willing to adopt a new environment? Supposing, for example, you're married to an apostle and God says, I'm sending you up country, and you are raised in the city. Can you adjust and fit into the village setting? So that is the symbolism that we get from the beautification with the oil of myrrh, so that you must be ready to be flexible at any time. If the Lord says, ha, you are married to a prophet, I have sent my prophet to go to the nations, I have given him a message. Let's say you are going to celebrate your anniversary, your marriage anniversary, or you had a plan, and God decides, I'm sending my servant to the nations to go and minister, or maybe I'm calling my servant to come to the mountain and seek me for a full month. Are you going to be angry about, you know, him not being able to be there and fulfill the promise that he made over celebration of your marriage anniversary or whatever it is? In other words, these men of God do not belong to themselves. They belong to the God. The reason why they are called men of God. Okay? Then the beautification with the perfumes. Of course, this has got to do with what comes out of you. The aroma that you bring out now. As a wife of a man of God, you must be able to speak life. Sweet aroma, aromatic words that are coming out of your mouth, from the inside of you, the smell, the sweet smell that comes out of you, that incense kind of, it must bring life, it must bring healing. So you cannot be negative, you cannot be pessimistic, you can't be anxious. And of course, we don't expect you to speak from a position of anger, of malice, of jealousy, of being envious. You cannot. So those are some of the areas where a person that is going to qualify to be this queen is supposed to be beautified about, so that then they can able to handle the responsibilities of the office that has been given to them. At this point, I just want to walk through into Proverbs. The Proverbs 31 woman, of course, that is a virtuous woman who can find. And I just want to go touching a few verses that I think are extremely important into qualifying you into this queen. Now, these are responsibilities. So maybe if you find yourself lacking in patience, lacking in endurance, and the words that are coming out of you cannot bring life, it is time for you to go back and say, Lord, I need to speak life. The perfume that is coming out of me has got to be producing a sweet aroma to the people that I am communicating with. And of course, let's go into Proverbs 31. I'll start with verse 10 that says, a virtuous woman who can find, for her worth is far more than rubies. The heart of her husband safely trusts her. She does him good all the days of her life. Now, we know that when the Lord brings two people together, on a general perspective, he brings this wife to come and help, to be a suitable helper to the husband. Now, you as a wife of a man of God, your primary office, okay, this is something that I'll mention at the end, but I can just touch it a little bit. Your primary responsibility, your primary office is actually your husband. Just so you should know. For you, you have come to make sure that he is okay. Not as a co-pastor, people that, you know, want to pastor the ministry. Even I'm a pastor, because I'm a pastor's wife, even me, I'm a pastor. When you're not actually called to be in the fivefold, but because your husband is a pastor, you also come to their pulpit and you want to preach. Now, unless you are called into the fivefold, the pulpit is not your place. Just because you are married to a man of God does not qualify you to also go to the pulpit or be a pastor or be a prophet, a teacher, evangelist, or even an apostle. No. It has to be an office that the Lord has given you as an individual. That is the only way you should qualify to go and speak on his pulpit or even attempt any kind of ministry. So the primary responsibility of any woman or any wife married to a man of God is you being the wife to this man of God. And later on, I'll be giving you the reasons why. So the quality that we are looking at this point is you being the virtuous wife, one that is so priceless, one whose husband's heart rejoices in her. So at this point, I want you to take a moment and ponder. If you are married to a man of God and you know that your husband is either an apostle, evangelist, prophet, teacher, or pastor, does your husband's heart rejoice in you? Food for thought. Number two, you must be trustworthy. Proverbs 31 verse 10 has just said that her husband safely trusts her. So does your man of God or your husband as a man of God trust in you, his wife? I don't know. Think about it, because I have heard of stories. I'll not pinpoint, you know, anybody to anyone. I've heard of wives of men of God whose husbands don't even like, I cannot tell my wife, I cannot trust my wife. They would rather trust in the church members or the body members, brothers and sisters in the church, rather than their own wife. When a man of God cannot trust you, his own wife, what are you doing there? Okay, you may have other things you're doing, but what are you doing? Your husband cannot trust you to handle certain things. No, it means you need to be returned to the Garden of Eden. And if you're watching at this moment, you are in the right place at the right time. Verse 14 of Proverbs 31 says, she's like merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She also rises while it is still night and provides food for her household, a portion for her maids' servants. Now, these are the attributes of a wife of a man of God. In other words, this is your ministry. What do? You will make sure that your household is in order, that it is properly fed. Why? Because your husband is a pastor. He's ministering to the people, the congregation outside your home setting. So if there is anybody that is residing with you, their feeding is dependent on you. I'm not saying food, money, kind of food. No. Spiritual food. The word of God now, the mentorship of the people under your care in your house are your responsibility. Why? Because your husband is busy preaching, evangelizing, prophesying, teaching, pastoring the congregation out there, the church, the ministry, while you attend whoever is in your household. So you wake up early at night, you read the word and make sure everybody under your care is well fed. Even when they go to church with you, you must do something about it in your very house. Verse 20 of Proverbs chapter 31 says, she extends her hands to the poor. Yes, she reaches out her hands to the needy. Generosity, basically. We know this. A lot of people look up to you. So they'll come to you, they'll ask A, B, C, and D. But even before they ask you, as a wife of a man of God, you should not be stingy and telling your husband, we are overgiving. No. Your husband is a shepherd, and you, even as a wife, you should be able to be one with open hands, giving, and never tiring. Verse 26, she opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. You cannot be rough, you cannot be harsh. To your own husband when he returns, to the people in your household, to any other person in the ministry in your church, remember, you are a role model. You are a role model. People are watching you. And you shouldn't do it just because people are watching you. This is a fruit you should desire, that you're first kind to your own husband, to the children, and of course to everybody around you. Verse 26, she opens her mouth with wisdom. Okay, wisdom is sharp, spiritually, and of course even on a carnal perspective. Verse 27, she watches over the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. You must have a strong work ethic. You cannot be lazy. For you to be a wife of a man of God, laziness has no room. Laziness, just so you know, at all angles, physically, emotionally, spiritually. You have to wake up at night and pray. You have to make sure everything is done. Every detail is attended to. You have to make sure your husband has everything. Your man of God has everything that he needs in the home. His clothes are ironed. Everything you must do for yourself. And at this point, I will say, you cannot be a wife of a man of God and you're relegating the cooking to the maid. A man of God that I hosted here in the Garden of Eden gave me a mystery that I loved about cooking food. Who should cook food for you, especially for a man of God? He said something that I'm still thinking about, that a person that is cooking food for you transfers the spirit they carry onto the food. Imagine now, if you have a maid who's not an unbeliever, some of you are ministers or wives of a man of God, and you have a maid in the house who's not a believer. So what spirit is she transferring to the food she's cooking for daddy or for the man of God when he comes back home? So you cannot be lazy. You cannot give an excuse. If, like, man, Like I told you, your primary responsibility, your primary ministry is to make sure the man of God lacks nothing. Like I said, I will expound on that a little bit later. So Proverbs 31, I think verse 30 says, give her the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates. In other words, a wife of a man of God that bear these qualities of Proverbs 31 is the kind of person that people would just look at and see the fruit of their labor, like whatever they have done speaks of it. So people would just be like, wow, I want to be like the pastor's wife. I want to be like them when I grow up. This is a common saying in this country where I come from. So people will look at you and actually just know you do not have to go. You're not trying to, you know, attract attention and all that. No, people will see your works, your fruit, and your fruit will praise you. Okay, at this point, allow me sip on my cup of coffee. I'm feeling like my voice is getting a little bit weak, so let me sip on my cup of coffee. Don't you go anywhere, because I haven't given you my tree of life for you.
Are you looking for that personalized bridal apparel shopping tailored to your taste? Or do you need to just relax and let the professionals handle your event planning details? Introducing Hems of Gold Bridal Apparel and Event Planning Services. For our unique bridal party, we design an exquisite selection of specially custom-made bridal gowns, changing dresses, maid-of-honor dresses, bridesmaids and flower girl dresses that reveal the magnificent splendor in you for your special day. Be the daring bride and stand out with our unique custom-made colored gowns. We also sell perfume oils from our Incense Uganda line. With our wide variety of long-lasting designer and niche fragrances, you are only one spray away from having that head-turning signature scent. Visit us today at our bridal shop located at Formatic Mall, Chiwatule Najera Road, shop L205. For details, call us on 0772-954-560 or 0756-954-560. Follow us on all our social media handles, Facebook at Hems of Gold and Instagram at Hems of Gold. Don't just follow the trends, set your own trend with Hems of Gold. Hems of Gold, your splendor reveal.
Be among events and decor. Do you have an event that requires a specialized decor and design? Introducing Be Among Events and Decor, an events and arts enterprise that offers fast-rate events, planning and decoration services. We have a talented and experienced team that offers unrivaled and genius event solutions packaged to meet your specialized needs, no matter the occasion. Whether it's a traditional function, corporate parties, intimate celebrations, TV shows or a wedding, we give you the vision in your perspective. Find us today at Jemba Plaza, room K152A on Luom Street in Kampala. Or call us on 0782-684-258. You can follow us on Instagram and Facebook at Be Among Events and Decor. Be Among Events and Decor. Affordable style, priceless moments.
Welcome back from that short break. You're still in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, this Sunday evening. Okay, I have got to wrap it up to move as fast as I can, because this is an extensive topic, and yes, I don't want to leave anything out. So what I'll do, I'll just be highlighting more of the qualities or more of the fruit that is expected from you, a wife of a man of God. And of course, as I'm talking about this fruit, just so you know, that is your ministry, that is your responsibility. In other words, if you're not yet there, if you're not yet bearing this fruit of the Spirit, you should desire or work towards receiving this, because this is a fruit. So you can just ask the Holy Spirit, not by power, not by might, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. And yes, this ability will be given to you, so that you will sit in your office and be the kind of queen that you're supposed to be to the King, your man of God, so that you will serve the purpose that you are supposed to serve them, and then glorify the Lord. Okay, more qualities defined. You must be slow to speak and quick to listen. You must have a hang over your tongue. Like people say these days, you must know how to control your tongue. You can't just be pam, 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 releasing every secret, gossiping. No. You must have control over this rudder. After speaking words of wisdom and speaking life, and the perfume is nice, don't just utter out anything. No. You can't just be talking. No. As I'm discussing things, some of you are wives of men of God, and you're like, oh my God. Oh. Some of you, the sheep, the flock, the congregation, you're like, Manangi, I hope, mommy, it is okay. That is why you're connecting right here. If you're a person that is watching and maybe you feel like this can minister to you, you know, your mama, the wife of your man of God, please send them the link. It is going to be available. It is actually already running on our YouTube channel. Just tell them that I saw something that I think you may like. Don't say a lot. Just tell them, Mommy, I saw something. There's somebody who was teaching about the ministry of a wife of a man of God, and I thought maybe it might interest you. Here is the link. Maybe you will like it. And you just send it and you keep quiet. Yes, because you're supposed to be respecting, you know, your mamas or the wives of men of God in your life. So you must have a hang or a control over your tongue. You're quick to listen, but slow to speak. Pay attention. Whoever has come to you, of course, that includes your husband, your man of God. The other is that you must understand and appreciate the benefits of sex to your husband and give it as generous as the meaning of the word generosity can be. This one I will emphasize, and I will send you to an episode that we did, the benefits of enjoying sex in a marriage relationship. Now, if you are a wife of a man of God, I told you, one of your primary responsibilities is to meet the need that nobody else in the ministry can meet. Do you understand? Now, this is very important. I have happened to interact with a few of the wives of the men of God, and you find a wife of man of God complaining, my husband, you know, he comes back late. Like the actor that played at the beginning, he's always counseling or he's always seeking God, going one conference after the other, one crusade after the other, one meeting invited here. He doesn't have time. And your husband comes back home and he does not get an outstanding performance. Why are you there? Do you know the kind of virtue, the kind of energy that he loses when he's out there serving the people on crusades, or when he's going to church to minister every Sunday, or an overnight, or a fellowship Bible study, whatever it is? These men are drained. He comes back home when he's like a car that is running on empty. Go and look at the benefits of enjoying sex in a marriage relationship on our YouTube channel. Watch and learn, and then go and do now. For you, if any other person is not going to have enough sex, it shouldn't be a man of God. They're supposed to have an outstanding performance, good sex, do whatever it takes. Or do you want them to be starved? Now, I cannot go easy on that. It doesn't matter whether you're 40, 50, make sure you satisfy this man of God. Besides, that is what you're there to do, so that you replenish the energy that has been excreted, that has been released while he was out there ministering. He comes home and literally their body is so weak, they are so tired. this you must do. There shouldn't be any excuse. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 5, defraud ye not one another. Even when he has gone for prayer and fasting, the Bible says it has to be with consent and then come back quickly. Do you know how much temptation, sexual harassment that these men of God go through? Do you know? They are being harassed. They are women sent by the enemy. Others just there. Of course, that is all the work of the enemy hiding. And they are there trying to seduce them, trying to claim their attention, and they are frustrated. Others come in short dresses. Others are all over the place. The man comes and he's frustrated and he's tired. And please attend to this man of God. The least that you can do is make sure that you give him an outstanding performance. I know of a man of God that once we were having a conversation. I think I've told this story before here in the Garden of Eden. He told me that, you know, marriage anchor, me when I get home, when I've come from a conference or a crusade or any kind of ministration and I get back home, I just want my wife to take off her clothes and we get down to business. And I asked him, why? He's like, because I come when I'm weak, I've lost lots of virtue. And one of the ways where virtue is restored, unwinding, it's like going to the gym, is actually doing that. So, Bambi, he shouldn't come and you are, the river is not overflowing. Please make sure the river is overflowing. Make sure everything is in perfect, as in, you guys, okay. I think we should move on. Point taken. Then the other one is that this man of God is the image of God in your life. Even as you're looking at him as your husband, you should not forget that he's the image of God and a priest in your home. So respect and honor him as such. In other words, if he has a grace, or of course he has, his grace, his anointing, should also be respected and honored. Don't just look at him as my husband. No. Before he is your husband, he's a man of God. You found him with his calling. He was ordained a prophet before he was put in his mother's womb. Ordained a pastor, ordained a teacher, ordained an evangelist. So you have to honor and respect his anointing in your marriage. You yourself, if it means sowing seed, activate this anointing, respect, celebrate it, honor it, exalt it, believe in him, believe in his anointing. Don't be a wife of a man of God and you're backbiting your man and you're saying, I can minister better, I'm more anointed. Okay, maybe if you're actually more anointed, but if he's your husband, then the Bible declares that, you know, the husband is the head over the wife. So at the end of the day, that hierarchy should be able to be respected, especially in the marriage institution. You may be better in your ministry, wherever God has positioned you, but in your home, he is the priest, period. It doesn't matter. And if he's a man of God, that is even more purpose or more reason for you to submit, respect him, and of course honor his anointing so that it can work for you. Yeah, some of you are married to men of God that are heavily anointed, but your home is lacking just because you do not recognize and honor them as men of God in your life. So my tree of life for you tonight. My tree of life for you tonight is that you should understand who you married and their mold of ministry. Can I repeat that? Understand who you married. You see that act that played? You will not complain. You will not, like I told you, ignorance of purpose makes abuse inevitable. If you do not know, understand, because he's a pastor does not mean he's just a pastor like any other pastor you have seen. No. Understand their mold, the way they are supposed to operate as a pastor, as a teacher, an evangelist, as an apostle, as a prophet. Why? Because that is what you are a part of, so that you will not misunderstand him when he says, God has sent me, you know, to the Philippines, God has sent me to Nigeria, God has sent me to Dubai. You should know how he operates so that you will not be complaining and failing to be the wife or the support that you are supposed to be. Some of you will not even believe that God spoke to them. Not that, okay, I will not go into those that do not really hear God, because I know there are people that started off well and they were hearing God, and they are ministers and they were anointed, but they have since deviated. I will not go there. But you can imagine, you are a wife of a man of God, and your husband or your man of God tells you that, you know what, my dear wife, God has said that I should go and do a month of a crusade or a conference, or go start a church. Let's say they are an apostle. Apostles are supposed to go out there and support ministries. Move. An apostle is not supposed to have a church that is stationed in one place. They be moving all over the place. And it tells you, now, my dear wife, we are going up country and spending there 6 months. And you're like, who? Me? My kids are here. The kids' school. I pity you. Okay. I will not pity you, because now you have heard, and I believe that you know better. So you must understand who you married, the mold of the unction or the calling upon your man of God and how it operates. Then the other one, that your primary purpose in his life is to meet his needs that nobody else out there can ever meet or will meet. So that is your first office in the life of this man of God. I remember that I said this at the very beginning, so I'll move on to the next point, that if you have a ministry as well, like you are a wife of a man of God and you have your own ministry, let's say like me, the marriage anchor, now I have this teaching gift of marriage anchoring, and then I'm also married to somebody that is an apostle. So how do we marry these two now? In the institution of the marriage, you don't come in as the marriage anchor. You will leave your office, your title outside the marriage, the home setting. Madam Prophet, Madam Evangelist, Madam Apostle, Madam whoever, when you come back to your husband, you are his wife, even when he's not a man of God, by the way. Let's say like me here, the marriage anchor, I am the teacher. When I go back home, just because my husband is not a man of God does not mean that when I go home, I'll be like, I am the marriage anchor. No, submit to me. No, it doesn't work like that. When I reach at home, the title stays here in the garden. I am the wife and I serve my duty and submit to him as the husband, as the source and sustainer as far as our marriage is concerned. I hope that is very clear. So if you are a wife of a man of God and you have your own calling, leave it outside the marriage. Come and be a wife at home and submit to your man of God and do and serve him and handle your responsibilities, okay? I believe this is very clear. I have tried to rush through and summarize it. When the Lord gives us more grace and more time, I believe we may have to go back and look at these things. But I've given you the hints of what you should look out for, what qualifies you, and of course, the responsibilities that are underlying your office or your ministry as a wife of a man of God. Now you're going to say, but marriage anchor, you're leaving out A, B, C, and D. Now those are the obvious ones, like you should pray. Like really, you want me to tell you that you should pray? Every Christian should, and you as a wife of a man of God, should I actually tell you that? Like I told you, I was looking at the mystery or the ministry that is underlying the responsibility of a role of a wife of a man of God, okay? Special thanks goes to Pearl of Africa Hotel in Nakasero for hosting the Garden of Eden TV show. We are grateful for this moment. We are grateful for the ambience. As you can look at this place, it's beautiful, it's nice. And yes, Pearl of Africa is located in Nakasero, Kampala, on top of Nakasero Hill, and you can stand and enjoy the view of Kampala, especially like now at night. It's beautiful. If you have a conference, a wedding, workshops, go. They have amazing amenities you will enjoy and get value for your pay. It's a wrap right here in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor. If maybe you're joining at this moment and you've missed this episode, go to our YouTube channel, watch. This has been and still is the ministry of a wife of a man of God, which is going to be put on our YouTube channel. Other messages are there. Go and enjoy. Have a blast. Share it with any person that you know that is a wife of a man of God. It's a wrap. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to the Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_marriage. Instagram, Marriage_anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden, a test of heaven's romance.